So two hard acts to follow. I'm going to have to, following Anwar and an Italian, I'm going to have to speak with my hands a little bit more. it doesn't come natural to Australians to speak with their hands, but I'll do my best. I'm going to talk about prostate cancer, which test when. I think these are my disclosures, none of which I personally benefit from, mainly for my department. One of the things that we know about prostate cancer, we've known for a very long time, is that it loves to grow in bone. This is, I think, the oldest case of prostate cancer ever reported. And if your pathologist, what have we got here? Sorry, excuse me there. Complain about the specimens you give them, somehow they manage to get PSA out of this bone. Paleo pathology works pretty well. It's a very interesting specialty, I think. In terms of, if we look at prevalence of metastatic bone disease in autopsies, and these are old data, you can see that patients who actually die of their disease, the vast majority of them have disease in their bone. And even if they have soft tissue metastases, they also have bony metastases at the same time. And so it's clearly an adverse prognostic factor. And so bone scan and CT for soft tissue disease has been the standard approach for biochemical recurrence, which has a different definition if you've had a radical prostatectomy or radical radiotherapy. But nevertheless, if you use those guidelines, the sensitivity is very low unless your PSA is more than 10. Unfortunately, in that group, the sensitivity with less than 10 is low, but the salvage rate is also only really achievable in according to surgeons or radiation oncologists if the PSA levels are less than 2. So there's this grey zone where the patients can't be salvaged or can't be detected. Could we do better than we're doing currently with standard bone scintigraphy? We know that it's both insensitive and lacks specificity. Well, there are improvements in the technology with PET and fluoride bone scans. This is a comparison of the same patient done with a bone scan and a fluorine 18 bone scan. And you can see the difference in the resolution here and in the contrast. And you have a fully 3D and quite rapid scan. The one on the left there is done in about 10 minutes. The other one as a planar image, and if you add SPECT, can be well over an hour of acquisition time. The major advantage of that is that you tend to decrease your rate of indeterminate and negative scans, which are important in detecting prostate cancer. And so that enhanced sensitivity is very important. And we can also quantify on PET the disease burden, which has now been shown to be a very useful prognostic factor and a useful way of also monitoring the progression of disease in the bone. The disadvantage of fluoride bone scanning is that it doesn't assess soft tissue disease. And a long time ago now, we started to look at PET looking at soft tissue disease with both FDG and fluorocholine. And somewhat to our surprise, both FDG, which was thought to be rather poor in the evaluation of prostate cancer, and fluorocholine was significantly more sensitive than the combined bone scan and contrast enhanced CT on a per patient basis. But importantly, fluorocholine found significantly more sites of disease than FDG. We had cases like this where we saw very small bony lesions without radiologic correlates, sub-centimetre nodes, and picked up the prostate recurrence. And our urologists really rapidly embraced this as a technique, and we stopped effectively using CT and bone scan for our high-risk biochemical recurrence. Some of the early literature also suggested that fluorocholine was a very accurate test. If we look at the pooled area under the curve here of 95%, sounds too good to be true, and in fact we now know that it is too good to be true, because there was a lot of disease that was below the level of detectability, but we didn't have any better standard to assess these. PSMA came along, it's an interesting target. It's an integral membrane glycoprotein, got a number of different names because no one's really entirely sure what it does. But what it is overexpressed in the order of 100 to 1,000 times in patients with prostate cancer. And it's overexpressed in more than 90% of all prostate cancers, and is associated with higher grade and tumour stage. And it's particularly upregulated by androgen independent and following anti-androgen therapy. That's going to go here. I first saw this tracer reported in 2013. Fortunately for us, one of the chemists involved had worked in my laboratory, and we were able to get this agent very quickly after that. And this was the very first patient we saw with a new diagnosis rather than biochemical recurrence, but there we saw the primary in the prostate, a small lymph node in the pelvic sidewall, and a rib metastasis. This patient had an equivocal rib lesion on their bone scan. And as you can see on the PET MRI correlation, a very small lymph node in the pelvis. And when we also looked very carefully at the correlation, there was a 4 millimetre anterior prostate focus that had not been reported on MRI, but in retrospect was clearly apparent. Because we'd been using fluorocholine, we did a direct head-to-head comparison in a small number of patients. As you can see here, the SUV, a measure of the intensity of uptake, was substantially higher with the PSMA. But you could still see the node, the presacral node here, on both scans. Where this really makes a big difference is when you have very small nodes. The higher contrast that you get with the more intense uptake allows you to detect disease which is below the level of partial volume effects. This lymph node was measured at around 3 to 4 millimetres and clearly seen on PSMA PET. And so we decided to abandon fluorocholine PET CT on the basis of that early experience. We, however, not everyone was ready to do that, and we had a large multi-centre trial run as a cooperative study between the UK, Canada, and Australia. And in this particular study, we had a multi-parametric MRI of the pelvis, fluorocholine, and in a small subgroup of patients, PSMA, which we added. And as you can see there, unfortunately, in terms of detection of extraprostatic prostate cancer within the field of view of the multiparametric MRI, the pelvic MRI had a rather low sensitivity, had very good specificity, a good positive predictive value, but rather poor sensitivity. So too did fluorocholine compared to PSMA in those patients that had both. I call PIRADS the poorly informative, rarely accurate diagnostic score, at least when it's done in private practice in Australia. I'm sure it's much better in Anwar's hand, but we've coined a different acronym for PSMA, which we call the paradigm shifting medical assessment, because it so often changes our management of these patients with biochemical recurrence. This is a patient who had a normal CT, a normal bone scan, and a normal multiparametric MRI. And despite that, as you can see, there is clearly a deposit there or uptake in the acetabulum, which in the context of multifocal bony disease elsewhere is very likely to be a metastatic deposit. We see this very commonly, that they lack anatomical correlates. In this sort of setting, this is really important because the high sensitivity of PSMA PET CT has implications for patients with metastatic disease that's potentially amenable to local regional therapies, or those with limited disease on conventional stage disease. So small lymph nodes like this outside the normal template volume for salvage radiotherapy, unless you know they're there, unless you can include them in the radiation treatment volume, the likelihood of patients being cured by salvage treatment is significantly reduced. We know that there's increasing enthusiasm for treatment of oligometastases, that there are long-term survivors with that approach. But it's clearly related to the burden of disease. If on conventional imaging you've got two or less nodes, the outcome is much better if there are more than two nodes, and that's particularly also the case if they're beyond the pelvis. As you can see here, if there's retroperitoneal nodes, the prognosis goes down very dramatically. And so if we looked at PSMA performance in detecting such nodes, you'll see that in this particular series of 83 patients, the vast majority of nodes that were detected only on PSMA were in the range of size that we don't normally call as positive on CT or MRI, a significant number of them less than 5 millimetres. And a large proportion of those were outside the radiation field or the surgical template zones that are typically done. And one of the most common areas that we see in the mesorectum, mesorectal area is a very common site of unusual disease. The comment was made that, you know, the sensitivity and specificity is imperfect, and all imaging is going to be. We're always going to miss metastatic disease. And this is probably, I think, the most rigorous pathologically controlled trial that has been done with a template radical dissection and very fine cut CT, pathology through the lymph nodes. And they looked on a regional basis for nodal detection, and the sensitivity and specificity were excellent, but most importantly, very high positive predictive value. When you saw a node on PSMA, pathology confirmed it in the vast majority of cases. And I think some of the false positives in nodes that have been reported are actually based on pathological sampling errors that they've not been seen. We certainly saw that in our early experience where patients were reported to us as having no nodes when we'd seed nodes, but when the patient came back for a follow-up scan, clearly the node was still there, quite close to a surgical clip in some cases, and the PSA had also been maintained. The important thing here in this study was that the median short axis of false negative nodes was only 1.3 millimetres. They're tiny, compared to the true positive nodes, which are only 5.5 millimetres, again below the level of anatomical abnormality. And this is an example of the immunohistochemistry for PSMA staining, showing the positive ones showing macroscopic or larger deposits than the microscopic deposits that are clearly going to be missed by all imaging techniques. In terms of comparison with multiparametric MRI, there's not many studies doing that directly. This is 39 high-risk cases, but the area under curve was significantly higher with PSMA than MRI. But again, this is both techniques are imperfect. They are going to miss small volume disease. We find it very helpful for resolving equivocal abnormalities on bone scan or CT. This is a patient with a number of sclerotic rimmed lesions around the acetabulum, as you can see here. They were positive on bone scan. As you can see, at least one of them is very strongly positive on PSMA. The other two are negative. We saw a small node as well here in the pelvis. And we also found another bone metastasis there, which in retrospect, there is a little bit of sclerosis on the correlative CT. It can also help with not just sensitivity, but specificity. This is an enlarged node, or called suspicious node on MRI, but was negative on PSMA in the context of a strongly positive node and pelvic recurrence or local recurrence. And so we were fairly confident that this was negative, but the patient was subjected to a salvage prostatectomy and radical lymph node dissection, and this node was confirmed to be negative. One of the issues that we face with this technique is it is excreted in the urine, and that can be a problem. We've adapted our CT technique to use a delayed post-contrast CT urogram that you visualise the distal ureters and bladder, which can be very helpful in identifying the sites of disease. You can also do delayed imaging post-void, which can help with the prostate fossa in detecting disease. Its performance really is more importantly looking at extra-prostatic disease. And if we look at this series of 118 patients with biochemical relapse, 91% of the patients were positive, with 60% of those having extra-pelvic disease, having distant metastatic disease, which clearly is prognostically and therapeutically important for these patients. In terms of whole body MRI, the question was asked. We've only done, as I said, a relatively small comparison. This has just recently been published in the Journal of Nuclear Medicine. But you can see that whole body MRI in this group of patients with a low pretest likelihood of disease in terms of bone, because they'd already had negative bone scans as a selection criteria, the rate of true positive disease on whole body MRI was lower than on gallium PSMA PET in that particular group. There are a number of new agents coming along. Fluorinated agents have the advantage that they can be made under GMP conditions and distributed, give us beautiful pictures, and have the advantage of a longer half-life, so you can do later imaging, and that can be particularly helpful for the prostate bed, allowing time for clearance of activity from the urine. In terms of combining it as a diagnostic marker for a therapeutic agent, PSMA-11, which is the standard gallium agent labelled for diagnostic purpose, you can also put lutetium on that and use that therapeutically. And we've reported our results, and I'll talk more about that in the theranostic session later, showing excellent response in a group of patients. Won the image of the year. In terms of, the utility of this in detecting bone disease, it seems to be at least as good as sodium fluoride, although there are some cases which are positive on sodium fluoride PET and negative on PSMA and vice versa. This becomes important because we can also use bone-seeking radiopharmaceuticals for the treatment of patients who have low PSMA expression or high FDG uptake. And so in summary, PSMA has been a game changer, at least in our setting. It's largely replaced bone scan CT and fluorocholine PET CT. And we think probably its major role is actually in selecting patients for PSMA theranostics. And with that, I'll thank my molecular imaging team, our uro-oncology team, who are great fans of PSMA. And this is our radionuclide therapy center. And I thank you very much for your attention.